first speaker of the opposition comes to you today and says that we haven't really said anything. We had nothing of a positive case. They themselves, ladies and gentlemen, had 3 minutes of a positive case. And they themselves are telling us that we had no positive case, we didn't prove anything to us. And then they ask us these ridiculous questions about our case, which we clearly answered throughout our first speaker speech. So they're the ones who didn't really listen to any of our arguments and raise these ridiculous questions, which I will answer before dealing with their 3 minutes of positive case, ladies and gentlemen, and then I will move on to my own positive case. Now let's really deal with the questions that they brought forth to the proposition today. They came up and identified an unfair burden on us, ladies and gentlemen. They came up and said that our burden is to prove to you why human rights are being preserved in the long term. That is not our burden of proof, ladies and gentlemen. Reading the topic. The topic is just how to prioritize asylum seekers who engage in armed struggles against oppressive regimes. Our burden of proof today, ladies and gentlemen, is to show you a need, ladies and gentlemen, and a right for why we should prioritize. And even if that was our burden, that is my entire second speaker case on how human rights will be preserved in the long term, ladies and gentlemen. Moreover, they went and said that by prioritizing these asylum seekers, ladies and gentlemen, you're intervening in state defense. Now, are you intervening in state defense? Well, these people are coming to you in the first place, ladies and gentlemen. You're not going into the country militarily intervening. In our world, ourselves, ladies and gentlemen, these people are coming to you, so you're not intervening in any state defense, ladies and gentlemen. So that point falls. Moreover, they came up and said that we didn't provide a criteria for oppression. Now, clearly, if anybody sitting in this room heard Haseeb's case, he clearly came up and gave you a definition for oppression on how it's gross human rights violation. Some team ideally doesn't understand what gross human rights violations is. That is not our burden, ladies and gentlemen. No, thank you. We did fulfill our job as a proposition and we did give you a criteria for human rights violations, ladies and gentlemen. And these oppressions we talked about. No, thank you. Not even that. We did not only give you definition, but we gave you examples of regimes that have carried out these violations, ladies and gentlemen, like India, like Syria, where people's fundamental rights are being infringed upon, no, thank you, by the government itself, and that's why we need to make a distinction. Moreover, ladies and gentlemen, no thank you, they brought up this whole point on how will you distinguish between these people who are coming, who are from armed struggles, and how will you distinguish between the non-violent people. Now, look, this is an issue about countries accepting people into the countries. Now, countries like America will not let anybody come in, obviously, ladies and gentlemen. It is an issue of great importance. No thank you. It's an issue of great importance, ladies and gentlemen, that we said that there are intelligence agencies that figure this out, and he himself considered, okay, fine, 100% in the real world, 100% situation, we will not be able to make this distinction, but in majority of cases, ladies and gentlemen, because of intelligence agencies, because of the important situation, we will be able to make this distinction, ladies and gentlemen. So then again, this point falls. Now, moreover, these points apart, no thank you, how am I giving preferential treatment? Now, the first speaker of the opposition spent 2 minutes asking us the question, why preferential treatment never shown by the first speaker, ladies and gentlemen, but we give you a need and a right to preferential treatment, ladies and gentlemen. Then they came up and said you're giving them an escape route and you're taking them away from the movement. That is ridiculous, ladies and gentlemen. You're not going there and kidnapping these people. They themselves are coming to you and asking you for asylum. That's why they're called asylum seekers. And we give you a need. There is a need to help these people because they're in a state of emergency. We created a distinction between these asylum seekers who fight against the oppression of their regime and normal asylum seekers, ladies and gentlemen. There is a distinction because these people are in a state of emergency. They're in a greater threat, ladies and gentlemen, and we have the right to distinct them from the other people, ladies and gentlemen, because they are working towards preserving human rights. And we live in a humane world, ladies and gentlemen, where we want people in Syria to be away from the to be taken away from the oppression of their leaders, ladies and gentlemen. And that's why we support these people really fighting for this cause, and that's why we believe it's justified. No, thank you, to make that distinction because they're fighting for human rights. Fundamental human rights are being taken away in the first place, ladies and gentlemen. Now, then they came up and talked about how we're choosing sides in the conflict by carrying out our policy. Now, of course we're choosing sides because we're clearly opposed to these regimes, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know why Team IBA thinks that we should support these oppressive regimes or really fundamentally infringing on the rights of the people. We're clearly against it. Of course we're picking a side, ladies and gentlemen. We're taking a strong stance against it, ladies and gentlemen, like the international community has. And then they spoke about sovereignty, ladies and gentlemen. We are not infringing on anybody's sovereignty by allowing people who are escaping from those countries coming into our countries and giving them priority, ladies and gentlemen. And essentially, in their world, when we don't do this, if you militarily intervene or take any other action, That is when you're infringing on sovereignty, ladies and gentlemen. And military intervention, because of the right to protect, is a last resort. And that is not in this debate, ladies and gentlemen. Right now, we're only essentially talking about people who come to you from these countries who are fighting against the regime, ladies and gentlemen, who are doing a good job, and we believe that they deserve to gain this priority, ladies and gentlemen. Has he even came to you and showed you why we need to prioritize this situation? We need to prioritize because they have a limited number of resources. And we're not rejecting all the other people, we're not being unfair to them. All we're saying is that we will deal with these people right now and deal with those people later, ladies and gentlemen. And I clearly showed you through my reputation, and Haseeb clearly showed you through his positive case why we're justified with the need and the right to prioritize. Now moving on to my positive case. Now, my positive case, ladies and gentlemen, is about how the policy of prioritizing these asylum seekers serves as an incentive and sends out a positive message. This, just by the way, fulfills the unfair burden that they impose on us on really fulfilling human rights in the future. Now, what are the stakes for, ladies and gentlemen? In these oppressive regimes like Syria, ladies and gentlemen, right now, armed struggle exists. We all agree to that fact. There is civil unrest. We read in the papers every single day that these people are rebelling, ladies and gentlemen, against these autocrats, against these oppressors, and armed struggle already exists. Now, we as the proposition today, ladies and gentlemen, believe that this very armed struggle plays a very vital part in overthrowing these regimes, ladies and gentlemen. Why? Because it puts pressure on these regimes, ladies and gentlemen. For example, let me give you the example of Libya. Now, what happened? 40 years, ladies and gentlemen, Gaddafi was ruling over Libya. 40 years, there was an autocrat, ladies and gentlemen. Peaceful demonstration did not work, ladies and gentlemen. When did we see some substantial change occur, ladies and gentlemen? When there were rebellions, when there were armed struggles, ladies and gentlemen. That's when Gaddafi himself was forced to leave this country, ladies and gentlemen. And now that I've proven to you why armed struggle plays a substantial part in really getting these autocrats, these oppressors to leave the country, ladies and gentlemen, I will now prove to you why prioritizing fuels this process, ladies and gentlemen, because we believe in a world where we will encourage opposition from within the country. We do not want to just go and march our troops in there. Our first option, ladies and gentlemen, is to encourage opposition from within this country, and via prioritizing, ladies and gentlemen, you are A, providing an incentive to people in this country, and B, guaranteeing a safe place for these people, ladies and gentlemen. What you're telling these people of the country, ladies and gentlemen, you're preferring people who engage in an armed struggle. So you're giving them a greater importance, ladies and gentlemen, so more people will be encouraged to engage in this armed struggle and really fight against these oppressive regimes. Moreover, there's a sector of society, ladies and gentlemen, that is too afraid to really go out in the open and fight against the regime, even though they want to. They don't do this, ladies and gentlemen, because they know that if they go out in the open, they will lose their job, they will lose their homes, that's why they don't go out in the open. But by the policy prioritizing, which you're essentially doing right now, is that you're guaranteeing those people a safe place. So they're, ladies and gentlemen, encouraged to go out in the open and fight against these people. We have nothing to fear now, ladies and gentlemen. So what essentially have I proven to you today? I've proven to you that every single reputation brought up by the side of the house to our case does not stand. Their entire case also, ladies and gentlemen, does not stand. And because we showed you a need, ladies and gentlemen, a right and an additional benefit for why our policy of prioritizing will make the world a better place, I beg you to vote yes.